easy to work with this paper.
Okay.
Cut!
Ladies and gentlemen,
yes,
I said you're French, but most of you are French. For those who don't know me, I'm Alex. This is the first presentation of the Taipei Forum for Discussion and Learning. The topic is the awakening into consciousness, physics, metaphysics, psychedelic states, meditation, and dreaming. The presenter is Ethan Kegley. He's been studying this subject about consciousness for almost several months, and finally he decided to share with us what he has learned. Well, maybe you will ask yourself, how come consciousness and physics go together? But that's in the top, because physics deals with matter, not with consciousness. Well, actually, I don't know either, but we will see what Ethan has to say later about it. And metaphysics is the subject of philosophy that deals with the existence of the world. So, is it like the background of the world, is it matter or idea? So, they divide themselves into materialist and idealist. So, idealism actually is what is the center of the consciousness. In the recent philosophy, there is a new branch called philosophy of mind, and it's a very systematic discipline of philosophy dealing with the mind, or we could say philosophy of consciousness. But the thinkers thought about consciousness during the Thai centuries a lot. For example, Buddhism. In Buddhism, there is one school is called consciousness only. Can you imagine this name? Nothing else but consciousness. And you talk about consciousness all the time. And some thinkers believe that the precursor of the modern philosophy of mind is actually the French philosopher René Descartes from the 16th century. He's famous by saying, "I think, therefore I am." So what does this mean? He tried to find a certain knowledge. And usually in a commonsensical way of thinking, if you ask someone, how do you know that something exists? So everybody would say, because I can see, touch, or feel, hear, taste, or smell. That's why it exists. So it always referred to the matter. But Descartes thought that we cannot get a certain knowledge through our senses, through our five senses. He thought maybe there is some evil demon who is lying us, and we think that actually we are sensing the things. So then the question is, how can we get to a certain knowledge? He said, okay, while we are thinking that we are sensing the world, while we are doubting the existence of the world, there must be someone or something who is doing that, who is thinking and doubting. And that's what he said, I think, therefore I am. So for him, it's actually the opposite from the commonsensical way of thinking, that a certain knowledge can be actually about the consciousness, not about the material things. Okay, I will stop here and give the stage to Ethan.
Good evening. Some of us have never met, and some of us have met many times. Alex did a good job introducing myself. My name, you who know me know at least that about me, what my name is. But, like Alex said, I have been studying physics, metaphysics. Alex is a philosopher, he's a philosopher. He's a philosophy student, and a great philosophy student has helped me a lot. I'm probably speaking very quickly, but that's okay for now. When I was young, I had an interesting question for myself. I thought it was interesting when I was young. I thought, is everything, all that I knew when I was 5, 6 years old, is everything contained sort of in what I can experience as far as when I Obviously, I can touch everything around me. I know that that's there. There's my mom, there's my dad. But say, at night, I could look up into the sky and I could see the moon, I could see the stars. I thought, well, is that contained within the boundaries of the earth? Or does it just go on forever? Is it really out there? And I also thought, I had a question that I'm sure you've all had, or probably when you were young, I asked myself, why am I here? Why myself and not any other person? You know, I was thinking, well, geez, my name is Ethan. How did that happen? Who is Ethan? What is Ethan? And why am I not, you know, why don't I have black hair? Why am I not 3 feet tall? You know, why don't I have an orange nose or something like that? I just didn't have any clue of why me. So I'm going to give a talk about consciousness. And I want you to keep an open mind, open ears, even though I might speak too quickly, and an open heart. I want you to be ready to, making this sound really heavy, but I want you to be ready to go through a paradigm shift. I want you to be ready to sort of think new things about what you may have thought before. Some people here actually actively study physics, metaphysics, other kinds of philosophy, ethics, you know, so it's not going to be totally new for a lot of people. So my speech, my talk is called The Awakening into Consciousness. I'm going to talk about five things, kind of physics, metaphysics, psychedelics or psychedelic states, meditation, and dreaming. So start with physics. Then if you're a physics student, right?
Yeah.
I had the pleasure of talking with Vendif about physics, which is fun, but you know, obviously I think you would have to be a student to really understand it. I just recently finished a book called Quantum, which was interesting for me. When I was young, I read an abbreviated version of Einstein's theory of relativity. But I was really young, so it really was over my head. I just finished a book called Quantum, which talks about the history of this search into the quantum world, from the atomic to the nuclear world, trying to find the fundamental building blocks of matter. What makes matter? There are a few physicists at this point who have sort of decided in their own minds that they have they're really, really close, and maybe in this generation they're going to figure out what the universe exists from or exists of. Einstein was searching for a unified field, something that would bring together his own theories and then other physical laws such as gravity or electromagnetism. He was never able to find it. He couldn't do it. But, you know, and I should have written down one of his quotes that just dawned on me right now talking about Einstein. But he did, towards the end of his life, sort of say, well, I think that when we figure it out, when we figure out what is the basis of the universe or for the universe or what do things come from, he said it's going to be very closely related to consciousness. So, a few physicists now, one of these people is a computer scientist. The other ones are physicists and may have studied other things as well. They're all authors. Peter Russell, Thomas Campbell, John Hagelin, and William Tiller all agree in their own way that they, that physicists now have come to the point of a grand unified field. Thomas Campbell calls it his TOE, his theory of everything. But he says it is his theory of everything, and it does not work for every person. Every person can have their own theory of everything. So, what is this grand unified field? What does it mean to have one? Basically, it is the point where the quote-unquote building blocks, the particles themselves, dissolve. And they don't really dissolve. It's not like you put a tablet into some water and it breaks up and you can't see it anymore. It just, you come to the point where you can't look any smaller. And if you try to, you sort of find this connection between everything. So these scientists give it a name. You could give it a lot of names, depending on what's your spirituality, what's your philosophy, what's your religion. But I think it's easy just to call it consciousness. So what am I saying? I'm saying that at the basis of all physical matter, there is consciousness. Peter Russell asks, and Alex said something, I can't remember what he said, but this will remind you of what Alex just said a minute ago. Peter Russell asked, how could consciousness come from matter, which we believe to be unconscious? We believe this desk or this pen to be completely unconscious, to have no sense of feeling or emotion or anything like that. How could our consciousness come from something as simple as skin cells, brain cells, whatever, not shirt cells, but... Okay, so, quote from John Haglund, we are the creators not only of our own destiny, but ultimately we are the creators of universal destiny. We are the creators of the universe. Okay, so I'm going to come to a close on physics because I'm not a physicist. Metaphysics. Alexander gave an incredibly great introduction to that, one that I just could not do. I generally am going to leave the philosophy to philosophers. I would love to be a student of philosophy, but I'm not. But studying philosophy with Alex's help, because I would say to Alex, hey, can you tell me someone to study? Just pull it out of a hat. This person and this person, go study them. And that's been a lot of fun for me. I'm going to mention, Alex already mentioned Descartes, so I don't need to say anything more about that. Perfect. I'm glad you didn't mention everything in my speech. But I will mention Kant and the Chang brothers. Only in the Chang brothers from China, only in their idea of this thing called the Li, which I think is extremely interesting. So Kant says that perception is what makes perception is what makes the object possible. You can think about it a lot of different ways, but I think that's very interesting. Meaning, in other words, if there wasn't perception, then the object would not be possible. Like I said, I'm not going to talk too much about philosophy because I'm not a philosopher. I just want to give these little points that kind of support my idea. This idea of the Li, the way that Alex has described it, because actually I haven't studied the Chang brothers myself, which is kind of strange. I probably should, but I think I would have to be in his class to do that. I imagine it as a ball. A ball of consciousness, that's the name of how I'm going to give it. I imagine it as a ball of consciousness, and that any possibility So we are all possibilities. Thanks. I guess that's why we're here, because we're all possibilities. You can imagine it, there's a ball, and some spike of consciousness comes out from that ball, and at the tip of that spike is us. That's just the way I like to think about it. You could imagine it as a sea urchin, one of those spiny sea creatures that goes around with all the spikes on it, that if you crack it open, you can eat it. So think about it as a sea urchin, and on the end of every spike is us. And we're all connected then through, down through the spike and into the consciousness itself and then out. So we're all part of that consciousness. John Hagelin describes it as an ocean of consciousness. I like the ball better because a ball can be any size, right? If you think of an ocean, you're like, oh, I know an ocean, Pacific Ocean. Well, it's finite. It doesn't go on forever. But anyway, if you're in the middle of the ocean and you look around, it looks like it would go on forever. But if you have waves, then every peak of a wave is, you know, any object or any person or any state of consciousness, whatever state of consciousness that happens to be. It could be you, it could be me, it could be a cat. So, let's see, a quote from, those are just the two things that I want to talk about are perception makes the object possible, and then the idea of consciousness and everything coming from consciousness. Kant said, live your life as though your every act were to become universal law. So everything that you do in your own consciousness, do it as if it's going to be part of the universe, which it is. Change the universe even. I'm going to start in on, I'm going to leave philosophy and start in on psychedelics and psychedelic states. You know, that can mean a lot of things to a lot of different people. I'm sure it does mean a lot of things to a lot of different people. But, you know, if you think back in the history of religions, spiritualities, philosophies, sometimes these psychedelic states happen. You think, like, I think of a good example being some person seeing a burning bush and thinking that that's God. You know, that's pretty psychedelic to me. If I saw a burning bush, be like, wow, we've got a bucket of water, we gotta put out the bush or something. But if I saw God in that bush, that's pretty psychedelic. Let me start talking about psychedelics with a quote from Terence McKenna, who I think was a great person. We have been to the moon, charted the depths of the ocean and the heart of the atom, but we have fear of looking inward to ourselves because we sense that, or sense what is there, sorry, because we sense that that is where all contradictions come together. Okay, so, you know, I'm not gonna try to say what he means, because for everyone that's gonna mean a different thing. But the interesting part for me is the fear of looking within. Say for the past 500 years, this is paraphrasing Terence McKenna, for the past 500 years, we've done everything you can possibly think of technology-wise, mechanical, you know, changing the face of the earth from, you know, more recently airplanes to, you know, television to radio, cell phones, computers, and then going to the moon and stuff like that. But, you know, if you ask somebody randomly to look inside themselves and see what's there. Are you afraid of things? Are you, you know, what makes you happy and that kind of stuff? People usually get uneasy about doing that. But I think it's very important. So, this goes into actively seeking psychedelic states. Why would anyone actively seek a psychedelic state? What do we need in this world to move us forward into, well, we're in the 21st century, but we're very early on in the 21st century. What do we need to move us through the 21st century? We probably need some new ideas. And I think we can find some new ideas through seeking out psychedelic states. I'm going to paraphrase Terence McKenna again. I thought it was just great. He says, imagine yourself on a boat in the ocean. So now you can imagine the ocean as an ocean of consciousness. You are you're a traveler out on the boat. You're also a fisherman or fisherwoman trying to catch something to bring back to shore. And shore is like here in this state of consciousness. And the ocean is the pure state of consciousness which you can go to through meditation or through dreaming practices or through actively seeking psychedelic states. So, you're a fisherman on the ocean, you go, you cast your lure out, you catch a fish that's like too big for your boat. You can't even reel it in. It's impossible. If you do, you put it in the boat, your boat's gonna sink. Probably let that one go. Cast it out, you catch this little thing that kind of looks like a fish, but you're not sure. You know, well, okay, let's try for something, you know, a good-sized fish that I can take back and share with people. And that's the idea of what a person should do when they go into psychedelic states, is to try to find medium-sized ideas that can be shared with other people.
Can I ask a question?
We're going to have question and answers afterwards.
Okay.
Write it down.
Okay, I did.
We're coming up on that soon, so don't worry about it. Terence McKenna likened that small idea that's probably too small as to think, you know, if you stick your finger in your nose, you go, gosh, you know, my finger is just perfect for getting into my nose. What's up with that? Well, that's probably not so important. That's not something that we need to think about a whole lot. So, going to DMT. DMT is deoxymethyltryptamine, and it exists in your body now, in your brain. Not exactly in your brain, next to your brain, in this place called the pineal gland. It's not actually inside of the brain when you're developing in the womb. It starts as part of the roof of your mouth and migrates up from there, sitting just between the hemispheres of the brain, right up close to the visual centers and all the perceptual centers. It's outside of the blood-brain barrier, so it's not specifically exactly part of the brain, but the pineal gland produces a lot of interesting neurotransmitters, and one of those neurotransmitters is called DMT, deoxymethyltryptamine. It's a relative of serotonin. Serotonin and melatonin. Serotonin is a basic neurotransmitter that tells your body, you know, a lot of different things about your everyday life. Melatonin regulates your sleep states. So, this guy, Dr. Rick Stratzman, did a bunch of tests in the 1990s. He wrote a book called DMT, the Spirit Molecule. And, you know, he's talking about DMT could possibly be DMT would be triggered to be released at night when we go into REM sleep. If you think that your dreams are psychedelic, right, because they're fueled by dioxymethyltryptamine. He studied DMT and found it very close to near-death experiences, spiritual, you know, this naturally occurring spiritual states where people think that the burning bush is God, and as well as alien abductions, interestingly enough. So, DMT is very interesting. It exists in your brain. It's actually a Schedule 1 narcotic. If the police wanted to be really picky about it, they could arrest everyone, and then they would have to arrest themselves and the president and everyone on Earth, because we're all carrying Schedule 1 drugs around us all the time, especially when you sleep. You're producing a lot of it. I could go on and talk about that for a long time, but I'm not going to. I also studied this chemist named Alexander Shulgin. Alexander Shulgin developed many, 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 many compounds. One of them that you probably know is MDMA, methyl dioxy methamphetamine, if I'm getting that correct. This is where I was studying him and reading this book by Rick Strassman is where I started to sort of go, oh, so all of these brain compounds are neurotransmitters. They can be synthesized in the laboratory and when changed. I mean, if you think about chemistry, we all had chemistry class in high school. It's very simple stuff. You know, atoms bond to other atoms using their electrons. Some, you know, molecular compounds cannot bond with other ones because they don't have the free electrons, blah, blah, blah. Chemists can change that and say, I'm going to add a nitrogen or add a phosphorus. So this is what Alexander Shulgin did. He said, let's take something like DMT, and now I'm going to add an extra nitrogen, and let's see what it does. He tested them on himself and his wife for many, many, many years. If you think that's interesting, you think he's crazy, well, he was careful. He said, how much of this should I take? Nobody's ever taken this before. It's brand new things, new to humans on Earth. You say, well, I'll take the smallest amount that I would think would be active, and then I'll take a thousandth of that, a thousand times smaller than that, not possibly to be active at all. And then work up from there until either he found that it was active, and he would find things like, well, this one, I changed it this way, that's very active on sound. This one, I changed it that way, it's very active on visual. This one, changed this way, it's very active on emotional. Or, I mean, that's what his work with MDMA, he figured out there are emotional compounds as well. Or he would find out that he could go up and take 2 or 3 grams of it. I mean, a big horse pill of it, and it would do absolutely nothing. So I started to think, okay, so you can, they're produced in the body, you can create them in a lab, and they also exist in nature, like plants like ayahuasca. Well, that's a combination of plants. Things like, you know, simple fungus or cactus, cacti, different things like that. If you take the active compounds, they're actually all related to each other. They're all tryptamines. They're either all tryptamines or they're phenylalanine, something like that. They're all related to basic neurotransmitters. So like, oh, okay. Well, interesting. Interesting because you say, well, I took that once and that, you know, I saw a lot of things. Yeah, because that compound works very heavily on your visual, it goes to where the visual neurotransmitters go and you see funny things. Okay, what's my time?
Yeah.
I'm okay.
You have to
go faster. I'm almost faster. These next two, because I could go on talking about that forever, these next two, Dreaming, just very quickly, have you had dreams where you fly? Well, that's interesting, right? Okay. Have you had dreams where you, it's called a lucid dream, where you actually wake up in the dream, you say, oh, okay, here I am at a table, I don't know any of you, I don't know why I'm here, I'm in a different city, but then all of a sudden, I go, oh, this is a dream. Like, how can I affect this dream? Usually I go and I run and I look for girls. I'm a really bad man in my dreams. Or I try to fly or something like that. Or try to affect what's around me. Open a door. Dreaming. Now, you have to think about if you can lucid dream, can you also have lucid waking? This would be waking. Can you wake up in this reality and affect it? Of course we can, right? I could do crazy things here too. There are laws against it. Or can I fly? Possibly I can. I'm not going to try soon, but it might be possible. Okay, meditation. All the people that I talked about, Terence McKenna, I talked about Peter Russell a little bit, all these people, Thomas Campbell. I didn't actually give any quotes from Thomas Campbell. I talked about his theory of everything. All these people talk about meditation, saying if you want to do something very basic to affect and grow your consciousness, meditate. I liken it to, and I'll just make this, I've got a couple more things actually. Consciousness, so you're at this point on consciousness, meditation sort of brings you down to the consciousness itself. Or if you think of consciousness as an ocean, it's wavy, it makes everything very calm, meditation. Leave that out. Okay, conclusion.
You're hot.
Am I hot? I'm okay. Conclusion. This is another thing that comes from Terence McKenna. I think it's really great. Says, I'm not going to quote him, but we're going through a birth. If you think about it, we each individually go through a birth when we are born, coming out of the womb. But if you think about as a global culture, as a global community, society, it's just all the humanity on Earth, we're all going through a birth at this point. Through an evolution of consciousness. The only thing that could possibly go wrong is we could create toxic shock in the system. It's kind of what's going on with pollution, deforestation, overpopulation, etc., etc. So that's it, the birth. We're being born into the future, I guess. Yes, so the importance of awakening into consciousness is to see at the base of everything, every object, every emotion, every galaxy, every dream, there is consciousness. That's it. Okay, I'm done.